I'll be quick. I'm Michael Parks. This is the Journalism Forum. Welcome. I now introduce the Dean Emeritus, University Professor, et cetera, et cetera, Jeff Collins.
Who has his name on the wall if it weren't blocking. Yeah. So,
So
our center has been having a series of lunches on topics having to do with women in communication and leadership that we've been doing with the Journalism School. And this is one we've really been looking forward to. And Narda Zucchino has been leading this series of conversations. And it happens that on so many subjects, Narda's fantastic. But on this particular one, both with her roles as a top editor of the LA Times and as a top editor of the San Francisco Chronicle, but also editing books, one of which. Are these for sale here, Narda?
No, I wish. I should have.
This one on the Lakers, which was did wonderfully. And also the Oakland Raiders and the San Francisco Giants. But she also was the co-author of a book on Pat Tillman. So really, Narda's life has been partly devoted to this issue of sports reporting and sports reporters and sports more broadly. So please join me in welcoming Narda, who will then introduce and run the panel.
Thank you for coming, and I think we have a great panel today. Carrie Van Horn, I'll give little small introductions. We'll talk for a while, then we'll open it up for questions. Carrie Van Horn is a sports producer and content editor at Yahoo Sports, and she aspires to be a broadcast journalist, sports journalist. While she was at USC, earning a double major in psychology and social sciences with a minor in sports media studies, she interned at a lot of places. She interned in front of and behind the camera and in the radio production booth and on TV airways. She gained experience at KABC and KNBC television and several radio stations, including ESPN LA. And she just graduated last year, so she's had already a great start to her career. So for those of you who are graduating, you know, she's someone you can talk to. How'd she do it? Robyn Norwood covered the Atlanta and the Sydney Olympics. She's an outstanding journalist with a great reputation nationally. She covered the Super Bowl, did those Olympics, the 11 Final Fours, every major bowl game, and the Kentucky Derby in her two decades at the Los Angeles Times. She was the first woman president of the U.S. Basketball Writers Association, and in April at the Men's Final Four, she's going to receive a great honor being inducted into that organization's Hall of Fame. She's written for many newspapers and online media, including ESPN. Jill Painter Lopez is a sports reporter and columnist for the Los Angeles News Group, which includes the LA Daily News, which she's been working for 14 years. She also has been named twice one of the 10 most outstanding sports columnists in the nation by the Associated Press Sports Editors, which is a very prestigious honor. And in fact, the last time they named her this was last week. So,
wow.
She's a self-described Jill of all trades, and she covers the Dodgers, the Lakers, the Clippers, USC, UCLA, the Kings, golf, and human interest stories in sports.
Los Angeles. Expert at men.
Lindsay Rhodes joined the NFL Network in 2008 as a host, anchor, and reporter. She currently hosts Around the League, the Top 100 series, and also has hosted NFL Total Access. She has worked for Fox Sports News, covering college football and basketball, and Angels baseball. She covered the Beijing Olympics for NBC and is a two-time Emmy winner for local sports reporting in 2004 and 5. She's a USC graduate in broadcast journalism. It's another success story for USC. Janis Carr has been a sports writer at the Orange County Register for 30 years, covering tennis, college football, golf, track and field. Currently, she's the backup writer for the Lakers and the Clippers, supplementing the work of the beat reporters. She earned a degree in communications from Cal State Fullerton, where she served as the school's first female sports editor of the Daily Titan, and she also was the editor of the university's first sports magazine, Titan Sports. So let's welcome our panelists. I'm going to start by talking about a study that just came out by the Women's Media Center, which studies the status of women in the U.S. media, and they issue a report. And this year they singled out sports as an area that is very, very underrepresented by women. Despite the increasing interest of women in sports and the prominence of sports and women athletes, female athletes, and females as sports fans, sports editors are 90% male, 90% white, and more than 150 sports newspapers and websites, the most prominent that cover sports, have received an F grade for their hiring practices among women. Failing to hire enough women as editors, columnists, copy editors, and designers, so that women make up only 14.6% of the total staff at all of those news outlets. Only two women, and some of our panelists are in broadcast, only two women, which is 1.09% of the group surveyed, were among the 183 sports talk radio hosts featured on Talker Magazine's Heavy 100, which lists the most prominent talk show hosts in America. No women made the top 10. There was another study recently done by the Associated Press sports editors about women in sports, and it said there has been an increase of women in sports color coverage, which you'll see on TV. You see a lot of women on TV, you know, interviewing Lakers and Clippers and NFL teams and coaches, etc. But still, and the majority of the women who are in sports reporting work for ESPN or have worked for ESPN, which really has, for those of you who are interested in going into sports reporting, a major effort to hire, to make the coverage more diverse. Many of you are working or have worked for ESPN? How many? None of you? Oh, but you've done stories for them, right? So I think you are certainly in a rare group of people who have made it in sports, and Carrie, you're beginning to make it in sports. So can you just briefly talk about your own personal experiences? We can start, I guess, with Robyn and go, how did you get into, and you've been in it for a long time, like Janis longer, and Jill, how did you get into covering sports, and what were the hurdles that you had to overcome?
Well, in terms of my initial interest, I was at the University of North Carolina when Michael Jordan was playing there. And if you wanted to see a game, you had to either camp out or have an official duty. So I decided that I was going to have an official duty. But the internships angle is still a very viable way. I interned at my little hometown weekly, and then in Orlando at the Sentinel, at the Washington Post, the LA Times Washington Bureau, and then that helped me get a low-level job at the LA Times covering high schools, but that was the foot in the door. One thing, and I'm interested to hear from Carrie if it still exists, at that time there were a lot of opportunities for women because there were jobs that had to be a woman. There were women and minority hires, and I don't know if that has changed or not, but...
How do you mean? What do you mean?
They would have an opening, and it had to be a woman or minority. And, you know, I certainly knew white men.
They didn't acknowledge that, did they?
Oh, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. And I knew, I mean, it's like affirmative action concepts have changed. But, you know, I knew white men who resented that, you know, reasonably, certainly. I think there's sometimes you hear now that there's sort of a whisper issue in hiring a woman or minority. But I don't know if that means that there were more opportunities at that time or not.
Well, I know it's illegal, I believe, now to say that a job is... You know, you want a woman or a minority in a job. You interview. Some companies have policies where you have to interview candidates from both
right.
genders and different ethnic groups, and then you pick from those.
Well, if it was not the policy, it was a de facto policy right. that they were working on. Yeah.
And then, of course, you have to work your way mm-hmm. on your own. How about you, Lindsay?
I actually started in his office, Tim Tesalone. I was here at USC and started interning in the sports information department, just kind of anything to get near sports journalism in some capacity. That was my freshman year here, and then he introduced me to a lot of people. It was a great experience, even though I didn't want to go into PR necessarily. Got a chance to see what all of the different journalists did from a radio and television and print capacity that came through the office, how they did their jobs, and ultimately met some people at Fox Sports West through working in the office and started interning there my freshman year. I interned there and then worked behind the scenes in whatever capacity they'd let me for probably about 4 years. working as a stage manager and a red hat and a production assistant, and again, anything that would let me near the production truck or near the announcers for the game so that I could just soak up whatever knowledge there was. And then they finally let me do some, not finally, but my senior year, they let me do some stuff on camera. So I was able to get some tape material together. And then went and worked in Yakima, Tri-Cities, Washington, my first small market experience. And then from there went to Santa Barbara and was the sports director there for a little while, and then came back to
a TV station.
It was a Fox affiliate startup that lasted about a year before they sold the station to the CBS station, and I don't even know that it exists anymore. I mean, I know the station does. I don't know that their news gathering organization does anymore. But so I came back down here, and those contacts from when I had worked all those years behind the scenes at Fox Sports West came in handy, because now I had a tape of me being legitimate. You know, I'm not an intern anymore. I've done this for several years. I know how to do it. So I started doing high school and USC coverage there, and then got a full-time job and ended up at Fox Sports West for a long time.
And then your current show.
And then moved over to NFL Network, where I currently am.
Jill, what about you?
I got started at University of Colorado writing for the school newspaper, and I was actually a broadcast major doing TV work for the school. And then got my first job at a really small market. I don't think that's necessarily the way people have to go anymore, maybe, because there seems like there's so many internships out there. But I worked in a small town named Hobbs, New Mexico, and I always like to ask if anybody knows of it, because is there anyone? So super, super small, and I was there for 11 months, and then worked in Odessa, Texas, covering high school football there, where Friday Night Lights was born. And I've never had better experience covering sports because, you know, people either loved you or hated you, and I've never had more feedback, even in the day of internet and emails and stuff. I mean, people were just nuts. So it was a great learning ground. And I've been in LA now for about 14 years. So, and then I think so many times, I mean, you hear about their experiences and internships, it's just, I know the stats aren't good, but we're all proof that if you work hard and you're persistent, you're gonna find your way and make an opportunity. They say hard work, what is the John Wooden quote about hard work and luck meet opportunity? Mm-hmm. So while those numbers, you can look at those numbers as depressing, but I like to look at them as, okay, we have all these, we're examples, so don't look at the, well, 90% aren't, you know, female right. sports journalists or broadcasters, but we have these who are, and you know, if you really want to get into the business, whether you're male or female, you know, just do as many internships as you can, and you know, make contacts and network, and that helps. Yeah. And have everybody now too. You can have a blog, Twitter, you know, Facebook. All right. You can get all sorts of experience pretty easy.
I'm gonna hop to Janis for a reason, because I'll come back to you. I have a reason for doing that. Janis, can you tell us about how you got started? How hard it was? Did you have obstacles to
it? No, because I kind of came in, like, there were, when I first, in college, in my first job, there was already the pioneers in this business, the Michelle Himmelbergs and the Tracy Dodds, and those are the women that really faced the hurdles and obstacles and kind of paved the way for people like myself. And so I didn't have that, so I benefited from, like Robyn said, that they kind of had higher females back then, unlike my two colleagues here. I started my career at the LA Times as a part-timer when I was in college, and then I got an opportunity to work downtown, and so I gave up my permanent part-time job to go to a temporary four-month job downtown, and it was the best thing I could have done because of the contacts that I made, and one of them was Bill Dwyer, who former sports editor of the LA Times, and then I went from there to Kansas City, and then from there to West Palm Beach, and that Palm Beach Post is the smallest paper I've ever worked at, and it's so I was lucky in that fact that I didn't start my career at a very small paper. And then after Palm Beach, I got a job at the Orange County Register, which is home for me because I grew up in Orange County.
Great. So Carrie, were you aware of all the pioneering work that had been done by women before you? I mean, when you got into this, did you think, you know, when you see women on television and you see women, you know, writing about sports and everything, did you feel that there had been this work done, or did you just think you know, women could just waltz into this and, you know, and become sports reporters. How did you see the women who came before you?
Well, I'm a little different. I'm a product of two journalists myself. My parents met at CNN together, and so from the get-go, I've seen the good, the bad, and the ugly of the entire industry. So I really wasn't blinded by anything. I'd seen hirings and firings. I'd seen people that I'd looked up to get told that. I remember I went into work with my mom this one day, and one of the women came off the set during a timeout they took specifically, or timeout, they took a commercial break for her specifically, and she was crying. And she ran by me, and I asked one of the other people there what was wrong, and they said that she needed to go straighten her hair because it was curled, and they wouldn't allow her back on TV unless she had go straighten her hair, so she had to run to makeup to go straighten her hair. And she was in her 40s, so I've seen such ridiculous things. I mean, I think that's ridiculous, but I really was not blinded by anything. I've seen before, just tagging along with my father, I'd seen other interns that were either on set or on location get yelled at for really dumb things or get told certain words just because they were female, or said, no, you can't do that, we'll let the guy go do that. So I really knew that I had to kind of muscle up, and I needed to have thick skin getting into this.
Yeah. Well, so what kinds of experiences did you all have? You know, I mean, when I talked about the obstacles, I mean, I was a woman journalist when there were few women in the newsroom. I was one of two out of 60, I think, when I started at the LA Times. So, you know, you kind of just do your thing, and you don't really think about, sometimes the resentment comes up, but, you know, have you ever had any really bad experiences that you, and how did you surmount them?
Probably Robyn and I, we didn't face that because those women before us faced a lot of that.
Yeah.
And I've heard those stories about players kind of start doing obscene things in front of the woman just because she was there.
Right.
I mean, that never happened to me. I've only had one time that I've never been allowed in the locker room. It was an NFL game.
What happened? Why wouldn't you? Was that before women were allowed in locker rooms?
The Packers didn't. I think it was the Packers. They didn't allow women in their locker. Other people had opened it up, but it was like back, way back. And that's the only other time that I've never been allowed in a locker room.
Yeah. And that. What? How did you feel about that? Because you couldn't do the reporting that the male reporters were doing, correct?
No. I've kind of always like thought of myself as just as a journalist, writer, and not female versus male.
Yeah.
And so there was another female radio reporter there, and she was all up in arms, and I was just like, no, I just have a deadline. Just give me somebody. So that's kind of the way I viewed it. I didn't like take a stance.
Yeah.
I didn't like get all riled up.
What about the rest of you? Have you ever had those kinds of bad locker room experience? Doesn't sound like
it's so commonplace now. Yeah. There's so many, there's women all the time.
That's the thing. I can't recall the last locker room environment that I've been in where I've been the only female.
Yeah. Like,
you're never the only female in the room ever anymore. In our production meetings at work, I was going over it, thinking about it last night, knowing that I was coming here. It was like our researcher on the show that I did last season was a female. One of the producers was a female. Our coordinating producer is a female. Like, there are very few and far between moments where you're actually sitting in a room at work in sports, I think journalism in general, and I can't speak for broadcasting, but where you're the only female anymore.
I think the biggest thing, like what I see, and Carrie and I have talked about this, a lot of young women are going into broadcast journalism versus newspapers.
And online.
And online. And the women that, these young girls that go out, and anybody who's going to do this, go out and hold a microphone or do the camera, the way they dress is, I mean, yes, I'm an old fogey, can't get it, but the way they dress is detrimental to the rest of us who've done so much work in this field. And when they walk out of the locker room, those players are talking it is not polite. That's why the worst part is when those players talk about the woman who just walked out because her skirt is way too tight or she's wearing too low cut. I mean, we've seen it, and it's,
you know,
that's my biggest complaint.
In any industry, this one, you dress you know, you dress how you want to be, you know, perceived. And so I think it's in any industry, whether you're on the city council or you're covering city council or sports or not. But I think we've really come such a long way, because I really loved the new MLB rules that were put in last year for attire. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't just, I mean, yes, skirts were mentioned in there. But I love the fact that it was like, you know, no flip-flops, and you see men and women wearing flip-flops, so you can't, it's not just about women and dress code anymore, you know, it's everybody, it's, you know, you can't wear flip-flops. So I think some men found, you know, those, you know, rules having to, you know, you need to dress professionally. Yeah. So it's, but it is, you know, it is certainly.
That's one of the things that struck me about Carrie, is that she didn't dress, I complimented her on the way she dressed out there. And I think that has gone a long way into where she is today, because I think people respect her. And I'm not quite sure you're respected if you're dressing the way
what you were going to say.
I was just going to say, I think that the thing that we all worry about is being perceived as being there because we have an interest in the athletes. Or, or
if we're serious.
Woman, you know, in other industries, women don't have such a responsibility to the others. But if a woman dates an athlete, I think we, most of us, resent that and feel that it's a personal insult to our professionalism. So it's sort of a, it's an unusual burden, I think. But that, it's like some, I think people who come more from an infotainment background don't recognize how verboten that is.
And I will say, based on what she said earlier, too, about how there were quotas almost, you know, for women, I feel like that does definitely exist still in broadcasting.
Really?
Although it's not acknowledged. Mm-hmm. But I feel like in broadcasting, roles are cast far more. You're not treated like you're not hired for serious journalism reasons a lot of times. A lot of times it's, we need a female or we need a male. Famous. And I've noticed, certainly, that the way they go about finding females is completely different than the way they go about finding males.
In what way?
Well, you know, you'll see someone who has no sports broadcasting experience trotted through the office that gets an on-camera screen test, and you're like, why? It's offensive to me that you're going to put her sort of in the same group as me when, no offense to her, I mean, what's she going to do? Turn down the job? Like, it's a great opportunity for her, but why do you look at the hiring practice so totally differently? Why is it that for a male, you're looking for somebody who's worked in a major market that has all sorts of experience, and for a female, maybe you're calling up CAA and saying, like, do you have a female that you can send over?
As if, you know what that is, that creative artist.
Like an entertainment, you know, agency. Mega agency or something like that. So, because my platform has always been, there are women that start in a small market, that go to a medium market, that end up in a big market, that have so much experience, and you don't want to put these people on TV, you know, because they're going to embarrass themselves because they don't know what they're talking about, and then it just reflects poorly on the entire group.
One of the women I was going to invite to this panel is Sage Steele, who is a television journalist. And she was interviewing an NFL player about his contract negotiations. And I watched the interview because there became an issue because her co-anchor on the show accused her, didn't accuse her, but after the interview was done, the camera went back to him and her sitting at the anchor desk. And he said, you had a little flirt, you were flirting there with... And she looked like shocked, and she said, "I'm married," to the guy, and he just kept going. So there's a little chatter about it on the internet if you Google it, and she put the interview on the internet for you to look at, so you could determine whether or not she was flirting. And I looked at it; I didn't think she was flirting at all. But it's that kind of, because she's a very beautiful woman interviewing an NFL player, doing an interview, and. You know, I think women, in this case, maybe women have a different style of interviewing where it's more personable or something, and we'll get into that in a second. I just want to tell you, when I was Googling, just to go to the point that you're all making.
Can I make a quick statement?
Yeah.
I was going to say, I love to focus on the positive examples, and that's so true, but was it Al Michaels, or who got called on the carpet for the BCS game with Catherine, AJ McCarron's girlfriend? Was it Al Michaels?
Yeah.
Brent Musburger. I didn't want to get the wrong one. But wasn't that great that we called him? Because it's like, he was just drooling, and really obviously was. So I think, it is kind of going both ways now, too, which is...
But that's a weird dynamic, because you have to, as an interviewer,
create a rapport with the person that you're interviewing so that you make them comfortable, so that you get an answer that isn't, you want to pull them out of their prepared answers. Mm-hmm. So you want them to just feel like they're talking to you. Mm-hmm. And so you're not flirting, but you're creating a rapport. You're trying to be personable.
And you see men do that, absolutely.
And mm-hmm. that, it's just people read into it and say like, oh yeah, you guys were totally into each other. I get that all the time on Twitter, you know, whenever I'm interviewing a male. Well, it's always a male. but you know what I mean? I constantly get that feedback and I'm like, no.
Yeah.
Just because there was some sort of rapport that, you know.
Even 9 months pregnant, you get that.
Less so now.
By the way, Lindsay's due date is tomorrow, so she gets a special appreciation for coming today.
We're taping this, so.
Yeah. when I was Googling women in sports journalism, I came across this. The Bleacher Report, which has a few women, but mostly men, writing for Bleacher Report. But these were some of the slideshows that they had on the Bleacher Report. 50 hottest female sports broadcasters from around the world. 20 sexiest sports reporters of 2012. We can assume it's going to go on year after year. 20 sexiest local sports broadcasters. 40 hottest college football reporters. And they're talking about women, of course, not men. but, you know, that's the kind of image, I think, that a lot of these, I mean, they're really reporting for a male audience, pretty much, you know.
Well, they're going for clicks, and that's it. That's why you see it more on the internet. I've seen very distinguished newspapers do something questionable like that, too.
The best thing about those lists, too, I'm sorry.
No, you've been on them, probably.
is how many people on those lists are not sports broadcasters or journalists at all.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't want to throw out Jillian Barbary. It has nothing to do with her, except for the fact that she's literally never worked a day in her life as a sports reporter in any way, shape, or form, is always on those lists.
Yeah.
Mm. And I'm like, I mean, if you're going to sit, I mean, seriously, it's like, you don't know the difference between us.
Yeah.
It's like a female that is on a sports show, sexy, go.
Aren't you on one of those lists? I think you are.
I don't know.
Anyway,
we could do our photo shoot right now.
Very attractive to me. No, because I that's one of the things that offended me by looking at those was that there were some, because I wanted to see how many of the women that I looked at for this panel and for, you know, something else I'm doing with sports were on the list, and there were some, and there were women like you, very legitimate, very serious journalists, who were on the list, and it just was creepy for me to see that, because it's not like they asked to be, or that, you know, sometimes women, if you're attractive, you're fighting against that your whole life in some, you know, for some, in trying to be a professional journalist, so.
Well, I think to the, to throw out a name, and it has, again, it's not her fault, it's not like, it has nothing to do with her necessarily, but the Erin Andrews phenomenon, it sort of changes the industry to a degree, because now I feel like you have people that want to hire people that are proven commodities in some way, shape, or form. They have a fan base. Mm-hmm. And so now you don't just have to be good at your job, you have to have a fan base too, which in the age of social media, you're like, do I have to then tweet things about my life? Do I have to tweet selfies of myself in order to be able to go to my bosses and say, look, I have 500,000 followers, versus if I'm just, you know, tweeting out whatever NFL news was interesting that day, you know, your number's going to be a lot lower. So you look at the people that kind of court a following and try and become a brand. Mm-hmm. And now I think it's so important in my business to be a brand, so that people will get hired and feel like, if I start a show and I put her as the host, then she brings a following to that show. But that's not necessarily good for us in the industry, because that has nothing to do with your qualifications.
What about those of you in print who don't have this issue? You don't have to be a brand, although you do have to, I think. I mean, now you all have, you're all on Twitter, right? Are you on Twitter?
I know you guys. I don't do mine for entertainment for work purposes.
Do you get an audience from Twitter? Do you? Where do you build your audience,
haters.
Or is it from?
I like the hashtag. Will do it, right?
What did you say, Janis?
I have lots of haters.
You have lots of haters.
I'll talk about Twitter just because I'm new age with new media. My sophomore year here, I took a class, and that was the second year Twitter had been out, and it was only celebrities that had it. I don't know if you guys remember, but Paris Hilton had hers hacked, and somebody was trying to steal her dog, and no one was on it besides people that were super entertainment. And one of my teachers pulled me aside, and he goes, you know, I have a really good feeling about this. You should jump on it. And I said, who am I? I'm not somebody to jump on this. I mean, I'm just going to get ostracized. This is not something that we should be doing. And he said, you know what, just step up to the plate and just do it and see how
Carrie,
it works.
Just so you know, I'm just putting your page up.
Yeah,
that's me. Cool.
Oh gosh. and so I did. And yeah. I'll follow back, I promise. and so I did. And I was fortunate. I was a student athlete here, and that's one of the ways I got my start. I got to see all of the LA media come here to report, and I was friends with the athletes, and so they trusted me, and it was really new, and other people were starting to say, well, you know, hey, more and more people are getting on Twitter. Oh, who's this Carrie person? And I was looked at as a trusted source because I was able to establish myself that I wasn't going to say anything frivolous. I was only going to be completely truthful, facts only, and that I wasn't going, if you were to come to me, I'm not going to give you anything but the truth. And I'm not going to give you selfies. I'm not going to do that. That's not going to be my spiel. If I want to get my start in this industry where it's so difficult with these lists, and all of my competitors that are female that are dressing, you know, to be pushed up and fluffed up, and I'm not going to do that, then I'm going to need to have a certain rapport. And so I did, and I started to gain this USC following, which is exactly what you're talking about. And they came to me for advice and about, you know, who's doing what in practice, and it was great. And that's actually how I got my job now with Yahoo, is that they found me. About half of their editing staff had already been following me through the past year to 2 years, and they'd seen, I had over 20 internships while I was in school, and I didn't have a car. So it can be done. I took the bus, I took taxis, I took the train now that it's there. I waited, I walked, I carried extra clothes in my bag. So it can be done, even though it sounds a little crazy.
Were any of them paid?
One.
Which one?
One out of 20
one.
Was paid?
It was KABC.
It
is no longer paid.
Which one?
KABC. They decided to pay their interns for a semester. I got $8.75, and they cut your hours, which really, for me, it was a restraint because I could only get so much time, as you said, at the truck, you know, in the studio, and it limited my exposure.
You all correct me on this. Excuse me, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
There was a federal law issue about unpaid internships. You have to be a student to have an unpaid internship, so getting, you know, so getting credit. So while you're in school is an important time. If you're not in school getting credit, it has to be paid, correct? Is that your understanding?
Well, he knows.
Well, since 1934, but they haven't enforced it. And USC, I gather, doesn't enforce it. It's supposed to be a documented learning experience. Mm-hmm. Whether you're paid or unpaid, but I mean,
I think we actually theoretically we do that to Michael, isn't it?
No, theoretically. There you have 2019 unpaid internship.
I would just say, too, I think we all need to brand ourselves a little bit. Yeah. Like, I know for newspapers, I mean, we're not just newspapers anymore by any means. We're required at the LA News Group to do 2 videos a day. And they're short, like 45-second things, but I got to pop one out here in a minute. we're required to do videos, and they want us to tweet out our stories, and everything's, I mean, really, there's so much about clicks and advertisements and all that stuff. So, you know, I'm guilty of doing selfies sometimes if I'm at an event, but I'm always dressed professionally. But I think there's my skiing selfie. I always try and put sports-related stuff, you know, on there, but just things that people might be interested in. And like Janis, for example, and Carrie when she did USC, and Janis Lakers, and Lindsay NFL, they have, you know, built-in, not built-in, but they create followings based on a certain sport or team, and then I cover a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
So I get, you know, fringe, you know, golf or some Dodgers or whatever. So, but I think we're all, you know, in some ways having to do a little bit of that.
Yeah.
I think we should ask the students for questions or the audience if you have any questions. Yes.
Well, Carrie, earlier you said that you had thick skin and that was important to you succeeding. I was wondering, what are some of the other characteristics that you think are important to succeeding in this career path?
One of the best pieces of advice I've ever been given was given in a very harsh way when I started. It was a news director, and it was my first day of my first internship, and he put his hands on my shoulders and he said, "This is how you're gonna make it. If you sit down, shut up, and you listen, and you don't do anything else until you're told to, you'll learn what not to do, and from that you'll learn what to do. And that's how you'll be successful." And I just sat there and was like, wide eyed, like, okay. but it's true. I've learned so much from showing up early. Absolutely. Even if they tell you don't show up early, wait around the corner or just be there, because you don't know who else is going to show up early. And then you can kind of small talk and you're just there. You're visible. It shows that you care. When you're there, perform all the tasks that they ask you, and then ask if you can do anything else. And if you can't, or they think you're being annoying, just say, okay, well, I'm still here if you need anything. And then when your job is done, ask if you can stay and clean up. Ask if you can pull cables, do something that's not your job to help make somebody else's job easier. You'll not only make a friend, but they'll say, wow, you know, she really likes sticking around here. Maybe we should keep her around to do something else. And so that's what I could
do. I think you should speak in all the journalism classes. It really has some good lessons here. Any other questions? Yes.
I have a question on reporting. I'm doing some fan research on the World Cup coming around. I was wondering if any of you had any focus on particularly female fans, the interaction between female fans mm-hmm. and female sports journalists. Has any attention been paid to that?
Female fans.
Well, I with the job I do now, I'm in charge of social at Yahoo Sports, and we have a really large following, and I, per my job, have to see every single at mentioned to us. I read all the comments on all the stories, all of the Facebook posts, Facebook, Google+, Pinterest, Twitter, Facebook, you name it, and the interaction that we receive with female fans is usually always positive. Even if it's a negative story, they usually tend to put a positive spin on it and they try to see the good. And then some other male will either attack them or support them, and then another male will usually support them. More so than the rest, you'll see female fans kind of taking a step back, per se, just because they're not going to be the ones out there that are going to be cussing, having barroom talk, and they're not going to be really assertive. But they do exist, and they're trying to get their voice out there. So,
what is the percentage of male to female commenters?
About 80 to 20. but I think that's because more males, I think they feel more inclined with the whole couch quarterback syndrome, where they just feel like they can say whatever they want, that they have an opinion on everything, no matter what it is in terms of sports, and you'll just see that. And sometimes they'll just say, oh, I was just trying to get a rile out of you. I was just trying to get a response. I know that I was wrong, but I mean, I got my response, so I won. So that's
well, that's an element.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
That's an element of the sports talk radio issue you talked about with so few yeah. women. It's just a little bit, even among female sports fans, it's a little bit less the dynamic of one-upsmanship or knowing more or being brash almost. These are all stereotypical things, of course.
Yeah. Right. Do the rest of you, do you feel that you're writing, do you ever think about whether you're writing for women or men, or do you think mostly you're writing for men, or do you just think you're writing for your audience?
Writing for audience.
Just the audience?
The audience.
It's a good question, but yeah, I think you're just covering the story. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we look at, I think journalism used to be kind of, you know, you tried to, what's the phrase I'm looking for? It dumb it down. But I don't think that we do that anymore. We just write for your certain audience.
The only time I guess I've thought about that is when I write something for ESPNW.com, which is their women's sports site. But even that maybe doesn't make sense. Why would there not be men who are interested in women's sports too? But you're a little bit more conscious of that dynamic for that particular site.
Yeah. I wonder if calling it putting W in it turns men off. It doesn't, you know, men don't go there because it has they know it's written about women. Is it written for, I mean, is it women athletes or women, women's sports, or
it's women's sports, women athletes. Uh-huh. occasionally there might be something that's male if it's a link to a woman coach or
Jeff. Mary, can I ask a question? Mm-hmm. I've had students who have felt that there are still barriers to women as sports journalists. I'd love to know whether, first of all, you think there are any barriers still, and secondly, whether, in your experience, you find that people think there are barriers.
I think people probably think there are still barriers just based on the fact of maybe opportunities aren't as much. I mean, if we just look at the numbers from that Poynter Institute, let's just say with newspapers, there aren't that many female sports editors, female sports columnists, female sports writers. So it's probably just a matter of opportunity. And I think there's so many. I've been lucky. We've all been lucky to have gotten, you know, received so many opportunities. So it's probably just a matter of working, you know, hard to get those opportunities. But are there fewer? It seems like it.
I think those numbers, and because I'm an example, I suppose, I think they reflect attrition too. I think there are opportunities, but how long do you want to wait outside the locker room? Or, I mean, waiting for it to open, but how long do you want to go cover USC football practice? And, you know, the work-life balance is an issue for men as well as women, but, you know, in my case, I decided I didn't want to do it full-time anymore.
And I think that's true. Like, there's a book out there called A Kind of Grace that Ron Rappaport did, and it's articles about women athletes by women sports writers, and I'm quoted in that, in the foreword of the book, that if my husband and I, who used to be in the business, had kids, that I'd be the one who stayed in the business and he'd get out. And that's exactly what happened.
Oh, really?
And and it's worked for us because he understands the business. And but I think what Robyn said, so many women back out of the business because kids, and they decided that that's going to be more important. That's going to be more
well
their focus at that, you know, at some point. Because it's hard, especially in like your case, where both she married to Mark Wicker, if anybody doesn't know that. But because the travel
you
can be
say
bad.
Say who Mark Wicker is.
Oh, Mark Wicker is the sports columnist at the Orange County Register.
So, but right, both, if you really want to stay in the business, you might want to consider not marrying another sports journalist. Because this happened to both of us. Uh-huh. She and her husband were both sports journalists, and he said, I'm going to take a job where I don't have to be nights, weekends, travel.
Yeah.
And, you know, I worked for 5 years after my son was born, but at some point it was just, you know, and I still work, but it's just we're not going to both be on call for nights, weekends, travel.
Mm-hmm. I just married a sports journalist.
The reason this happens is they talk about a 24-hour-7 news cycle, and they mean one person.
Like Carrie's finding out that she's working 12-hour days, and so you're kind of with the same people, and so your social life.
And you're not going to date the athletes.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So, not us. So you're left with them.
I think in terms of barriers, for me, I felt like there were more perceived barriers earlier in my career than there actually were. I went into this business feeling relatively defensively, but I'm kind of glad that I did, because I think it forced me to behave a certain way. I was always very, very, very conscious of the way I was perceived by others, and that affected my dress, that affected my demeanor, that affected my interaction with athletes. I never wanted to be perceived as being flirty. I never wanted to be perceived as, so I would always take a step back maybe before I got to that point. Sometimes I think detrimentally so, because honestly, and this is something I still deal with today, I don't know totally how to build up sources, because I think it's harder for women to do that, and women clearly do that, but it's a weird relationship dynamic. I think if you're covering, like if I was covering USC football every day, it's a little bit easier because you're interacting with people on a regular basis. They know who you are, and you can pull people aside. They know what you're about, and the people that you're around know what you're about and whether you're interested or not, you know? But like on a national level, I have a hard time dealing with creating that dynamic so that, okay, so now we're gonna be kind of friends, sort of. Like, you know, you're gonna maybe give me some information every once in a while, I'm gonna, you know, whatever. But there's always a weird moment, or there sometimes is a weird moment. Sometimes there's not. Sometimes people are just totally professional, but sometimes people are unprofessional, and you're like, I don't know how to handle this situation, so how do I back out? How do I maintain a professional relationship? So I've kind of gone down a road where I just haven't created many of those relationships.
And if you think about the perspective of the male athlete's wife or girlfriend, because they do experience this groupie dynamic, they may be suspicious of you. So one, you know, can't do this on a national basis so much, but if you're on a beat, a pro beat, that's a good thing to know the wives and girlfriends so that they know that you're not
threatening in any way.
Or, you know, it's like, I'm sure, like, a male colleague can ask Pau Gasol for his, you know, email address or his, you know, phone number to get in touch with them. Whereas I kind of look, I feel awkward doing that because it's kind of like, you know, I don't want.
Yeah, why do you want my number?
Yeah.
Bob has.
I've had phone calls. I've been drunk dialed in the middle of the night by athletes.
Oh, you've been what?
Drunk dialed.
Wow.
And it created a very, very awkward moment because the specific instance that I'm thinking of, it was somebody that I needed to have a relationship with professionally. And I felt really violated, and I was very angry. Like, you just put me in a really uncomfortable position with my husband. I'm getting a phone call in the middle of the night, and it's clearly not work-related.
Yeah.
And why are you calling me? And so I got off the phone as fast as I could, but then I didn't know how to handle it when I saw him next at work. I was like, because I need you, you know? Yeah. I need to be able to talk to you after games.
How did you handle that?
I was going to have
I sort of didn't.
Yeah.
I kind of just, like, I made a, like, a joke about the inappropriateness, you know? I kept it light and got off the phone really fast and then didn't really address it. And I'm not sure what the right way to handle
maybe
it.
Maybe he was as embarrassed as you.
Hope he forgot.
Yeah. Blacked out. Bob has a question.
Yeah, I just wonder, in this different news environment, which is quite competitive, how much of a threat is there to journalistic independence? And I'll take USC as a laboratory. It's a major sports story. To what degree can you cover stories that are embarrassing to USC? To what degree do you need access? These kind of questions. And related questions, are you going to do a story on unpaid internships? Do we do stories on, say, the racial composition of the student body at UCLA, which has been a story that's come up in a sports environment, or the funding of female sports as opposed to male, and so forth. So, particularly for the older journalists, has it changed at all? I mean, there was a time, I guess, when the Register and its market was dominant, didn't have to worry about all these other, or the LA Times, these competitors. Is it now, are you scrambling for access in a different way?
Well, there, you know, the olden days, before us. the journalists used to travel on the trains with, and they would go drinking with them, and it was, I don't know how they managed all that.
Yeah.
But I will say that one thing I've seen change, in particular USC, and Tim, I think, knows what's coming, is it used to be you would have phone numbers of some athletes, and people may still, or you would catch them on campus, but especially after the NCAA issues, it's a lot tighter. And they're asking the athletes not to respond to you, not to give out their numbers, not to talk to you except in very, very controlled situations. And that does make you feel, it makes you feel like you can't do the job the way you want to. It also makes you feel like you get reduced to sort of a packed journalism where whatever question you ask, everybody is getting your stuff. You can't use your skills or knowledge because you can't get the person alone to ask them other things.
And then on the pro level, like especially in the NBA, like, Kobe Bryant is not going to tell any of the beat writers something. He's going to go to Adrian Wojnarowski at Yahoo because they go to the national guys. And so the beat guys are constantly scrambling to follow the national guys because they know that that's going to get out bigger than just LA. And so we fight that a lot as beat reporters here. And I'm sure it's everywhere. They will go national, or else a lot of athletes now are breaking stories themselves on Twitter or Facebook. Like Derek Jeter went on Facebook to announce his retirement. So there scoops today, breaking stories today. It's really hard to do because you just you don't get
and
that.
And once you break it, it lasts 2 minutes.
Yeah.
And then other people are confirming it.
Yeah.
Yes. They're breaking it themselves.
Yeah,
although
I can confirm.
Has learned.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. You have like 8 sources all in a row on Twitter that have all individually confirmed the same story.
And then in answer to your other part of the question, real fast, about like covering embarrassing stories. I mean, I know like the Tim Tussle, for example, I mean, he knows we're here to do our jobs, whether that's covering something that makes the university look good, covering something that makes the university look bad, Lane Kiffin, probation, all that. I mean, they know we are here to do our job, and usually they're not trying to get in your way because they, you know, they know that, you know, we're covering us. We're covering stories, whatever, you know, the stories may be. So I think most, in this day and age, most sports information directors are, I mean, they're good about that. They know that. So we're always welcome. So
there is an element from a broadcast standpoint sometimes because partnerships come into play. So if you work for Fox Sports Net and you are a television partner with the, who are they television partners with anymore? Like we're nobody. With the Angels. I was going to say with the Lakers or you know what I mean? But like when you are the television rights holder, there's a partnership that's implied at a higher level than you are at the network. Like it doesn't come into your mind at all ever. You're just trying to ask good questions and come up with good content. But you know to a degree that your boss is invested in the
It's like Time Warner Cable and the Lakers. I've watched like their reporters and Dave Miller, who's one of their guys at Time Warner, and he will say, "Janis, thank you for asking that because I can't ask that. You know, it'll be a negative question." And so they can't because they've paid $50 million to the Lakers. And so they can't ask negative questions.
I have asked negative questions before because and this might be part of the perception thing about the barriers, like I'll do it anyway because I feel like I need to prove myself, maybe more so than I do, that I'm not going to ask fluffy questions and be that girl. So I have asked those questions before and maybe sometimes not gauged the environment correctly. Mm-hmm. Like on the floor, I asked Lamar Odom one time right before the trade deadline, and it was the walk-off interview that was broadcast to the house, and he'd finally had a good game and he'd been awful, and I asked him a question about like the timing of it and whether they were showcasing him or something like that because it was so out of the norm for what he'd been doing lately. And Phil Jackson went off on me the next day and his little reporter powwow, and my boss, as soon as I got back to the office, my boss had already received phone calls from the Lakers about how inappropriate it was that I'd asked in that environment. And then Mike Bresnahan, who covers the team for the Lakers, came up to me and was like, those were actually legitimate questions that I might have actually asked, which you never get on the walk-off, but you kind of have to gauge that because I didn't necessarily make any friends in the Lakers organization by doing it there. I would have been fine asking it at the locker.
And I,
my thought was like, this is my one-on-one. This is I'm going to ask the question. Right. If I can be the first person to ask this, and I know everyone's going to ask it when we get to the locker, then I'm going to ask that question.
There's a question. Someone here wanted to.
As females in the business, maybe not so much now, but when you first started, do you feel like you're tested or quizzed on your knowledge or motives more than males in the business?
Probably early on.
I'm not usually, but when I was in my early 20s at an Angels game, and I think old manager Jimmy Williams was there with Toronto or something, I've sort of lost track, but I asked a question about a pitch, location of pitch, and he wanted to know how wide the plate was, and I'm like, I think it's 18 inches. Nobody else got asked how wide the plate was.
I used to get those questions. I don't get those questions as much anymore because I think people that I interact with outside of the business now to a degree know who I am and know what I do. But when I was earlier in my career, people's boyfriends, friends' boyfriends, things like that, it wasn't people in the industry, it was people that I would meet socially. They'd be like, really, you do that? Do you like sports? And I'm like, seriously though? Like, if I was a guy, would you ask me if I liked sports, if I was covering sports professionally? This is an awesome job. And of course I like sports if I'm doing this. But and then, you know, you'd get quizzed every once in a while. And I kind of got to a point in my career where I was like, I'm not doing your quiz.
I'm
not answering your questions.
I have to say that,
who are you?
I did get one response on Twitter not too long ago that some guy told me that I probably would be better off in the kitchen.
Not barefoot, just in the kitchen.
I promise you I would not be better off.
Did you tell him your husband?
How do you boil that water, sir?
Nora, this has been a great panel. I say one of the reasons it's been so interesting to me is I think not only have you all been fantastic, but also you've presented a lot of issues that I want to think about how we teach students, not just about sports journalism, the question of dealing with sources and what do you do when a source, it could be a political source, it could be a source in a business story, but when they go past that barrier, how do you deal with those issues in every field? And it's really important, I think, for us to think
I'll
about
sign up for that class.
Well, you may sign up to teach that class. Anyway, Nora and this group, thank you so much for this.
Thank you.